Books on Tape presents My Life by William Jefferson Clinton, Volume 1, read by Michael Beck. Prologue and epilogue read by the author.
When I was a young man just out of law school and eager to get on with my life, on a whim, I briefly put aside my reading preference for fiction and history and bought one of those how-to books, How to Get Control of Your Time and Your Life by Alan Lakin. The book's main point was the necessity of listing short, medium, and long-term life goals, then categorizing them in order of their importance, with the A group being the most important, the B group next, and the C the last, then listing under each goal specific activities designed to achieve them. I still have that paperback book, now almost 30 years old. And I'm sure I have that old list somewhere buried in my papers, though I can't find it. However, I do remember the A list. I wanted to be a good man, have a good marriage and children, have good friends, make a successful political life, and write a great book. Whether I'm a good man is, of course, for God to judge. I know that I'm not as good as my strongest supporters believe, or as I hope to become, nor as bad as my harshest critics assert. I have been graced beyond measure by my family life with Hillary and Chelsea. Like all families' lives, ours is not perfect, but it has been wonderful. Its flaws, as all the world knows, are mostly mine, and its continuing promise is grounded in their love. No person I know ever had more or better friends. Indeed, a strong case can be made that I rose to the presidency on the shoulders of my personal friends, the now legendary FOBs. My life in politics was a joy. I love campaigns and I love governing. I always tried to keep things moving in the right direction, to give more people a chance to live their dreams, to lift people's spirits, and to bring them together. That's the way I kept score. As for the great book, who knows? It sure is a good story.
Chapter 1. Early on the morning of August 19, 1946, I was born under a clear sky after a violent summer storm to a widowed mother in the Julia Chester Hospital in Hope, a town of about 6,000 in southwest Arkansas, 33 miles east of the Texas border at Texarkana. My mother named me William Jefferson Blythe III after my father, William Jefferson Blythe Jr., one of nine children of a poor farmer in Sherman, Texas, who died when my father was 17. According to his sisters, my father always tried to take care of them, and he grew up to be a handsome, hard-working, fun-loving man. He met my mother at Tri-State Hospital in Shreveport, Louisiana, in 1943, when she was training to be a nurse. Many times when I was growing up, I asked Mother to tell me the story of their meeting, courting, and marriage. He brought a date with some kind of medical emergency into the ward where she was working, and they talked and flirted while the other woman was being treated. On his way out of the hospital, he touched the finger on which she was wearing her boyfriend's ring and asked her if she was married. She stammered no, she was single. The next day, he sent the other woman flowers, and her heart sank. Then he called Mother for a date, explaining that he always sent flowers when he ended a relationship. 2 months later, they were married, and he was off to war. He served in a motor pool in the invasion of Italy, repairing jeeps and tanks. After the war, he returned to Hope for Mother, and they moved to Chicago, where he got back his old job as a salesman for the Manby Equipment Company. They bought a little house in the suburb of Forest Park, but couldn't move in for a couple of months, and since Mother was pregnant with me, they decided she should go home to Hope until they could get into the new house. On May 17, 1946, after moving their furniture into their new home, my father was driving from Chicago to Hope to fetch his wife. Late at night on Highway 60 outside of Sykeston, Missouri, he lost control of his car, a 1942 Buick, when the right front tire blew out on a wet road. He was thrown clear of the car but landed in or crawled into a drainage ditch dug to reclaim swampland. The ditch held 3 feet of water. When he was found after a 2-hour search, his hand was grasping a branch above the waterline. He had tried but failed to pull himself out. He drowned, only 28 years old, married 2 years and 8 months, only 7 months of which he had spent with mother. That brief sketch is about all I ever really knew about my father. All my life, I have been hungry to fill in the blanks, clinging eagerly to every photo or story or scrap of paper that would tell me more of the man who gave me life. When I was about 12, sitting on my Uncle Buddy's porch in Hope, a man walked up the steps, looked at me, and said, "You're Bill Bly's son. You look just like him." I beamed for days. In 1974, I was running for Congress. It was my first race, and the local paper did a feature story on my mother. She was at her regular coffee shop early in the morning discussing the article with a lawyer friend when one of the breakfast regulars she knew only casually came up to her and said, "I was there. I was the first one at the wreck that night." He then told my mother what he had seen, including the fact that my father had retained enough consciousness or survival instinct to try to claw himself up and out of the water before he died. Mother thanked him, went out to her car and cried, then dried her tears and went to work. In 1993, on Father's Day, my first as president, the Washington Post ran a long investigative story on my father, which was followed over the next 2 months by other investigative pieces by the Associated Press and many smaller papers. The stories confirmed the things my mother and I knew. They also turned up a lot we didn't know, including the fact that my father had probably been married 3 times before he met mother, and apparently had at least 2 more children. My father's other son was identified as Leon Ritzenthaler, a retired owner of a janitorial service from Northern California. In the article, he said he had written me during the 92 campaign, but had received no reply. I don't remember hearing about his letter, and considering all the other bullets we were dodging then, it's possible that my staff kept it from me, or maybe the letter was just misplaced in the mountains of mail we were receiving. Anyway, when I read about Leon, I got in touch with him and later met him and his wife Judy during one of my stops in Northern California. We had a happy visit, and since then we've corresponded in holiday seasons. He and I look alike. His birth certificate says his father was mine, and I wish I'd known about him a long time ago. Somewhere around this time, I also received information confirming news stories about a daughter, Sharon Pettyjohn, born Sharon Lee Blythe in Kansas City in 1941, to a woman my father later divorced. She sent copies of her birth certificate, her parents' marriage license, a photo of my father, and a letter to her mother from my father asking about our baby to Betsy Wright, my former chief of staff in the governor's office. I'm sorry to say that for whatever reason, I've never met her. This news breaking in 1993 came as a shock to mother, who by then had been battling cancer for some time, but she took it all in stride. She said young people did a lot of things during the Depression and the war that people in another time might disapprove of. What mattered was that my father was the love of her life, and she had no doubt of his love for her. Whatever the facts, that's all she needed to know as her own life moved toward its end. As for me, I wasn't quite sure what to make of it all. But given the life I've led, I could hardly be surprised that my father was more complicated than the idealized pictures I had lived with for nearly a half a century. In 1994, as we headed for the celebration of the 50th anniversary of D-Day, several newspapers published a story on my father's war record with a snapshot of him in uniform. Shortly afterward, I received a letter from Umberto Barron of Netcong, New Jersey, recounting his own experiences during the war and after. He said that he was a young boy in Italy when the Americans arrived, and that he loved to go into their camp, where one soldier in particular befriended him, giving him candy and showing him how engines worked and how to repair them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.